Okay, perfect. Thanks. Yeah, thanks for the organizer to make this happen like so quickly. This is joint work with Robert Gonzalez at the University of South Carolina. And we are discussing cell phone access and epidemic containing efforts. So infectious diseases remain, and outbreaks in general remain a major burden in several countries. We are just facing the coronavirus virus. In the recent decade, there have been the swine flu, the Ebola epidemic in West Africa, in Democratic Republic of Congo, and the Zika virus in Latin America, just to mention a few. And so the understanding the effectiveness of certain tools to contain the spread of these diseases remain first order policy issues. And we think that mobile phone technology has been established and can be used as a powerful tool to either share information about the disease or the proper behavior to diagnose the disease, to predict the spread, or even deliver the healthcare. And specific mobile phone application, for example, has been used in the past in specific outbreaks. But here today, we're trying to answer a kind of broader question. That is whether cell phone access among the general population can help or contain or even maybe contribute to the spread of a disease at the time of a health crisis, or at the time of an outbreak of an infectious disease. So the context is the 2014 Ebola virus disease epidemic in Liberia, that was one of the three most affected countries in 2013, 2016. I will always refer to AVD going forward. And what we are trying to do here is using mobile phone coverage as a proxy for cell phone access to try to answer this question. And just to keep in mind before I go in the details, we are really trying to estimate the causal effect of cell phone access on the likelihood of an Ebola case in a village using a regression discontinuity design, where we are exploiting the threshold for which there is coverage and people can use the phone and send a text message or make a call. And on the other side of the border of the threshold, there is no cell phone coverage. So ex ante, we think the relationship between cell phone access and the disease, in this case, Ebola virus disease, is ambiguous. So on one side, we think the relationship can be positive in the sense that cell phone access can even increase the likelihood of having a case of Ebola. This might happen if cell phone access is a proxy for people having a larger, more accessible network. This has been established in the literature. People that have cell phone are more likely to have a larger social network. If that's the case, and if people rely on their social network to get information or to access care somehow, then the relationship can be positive. And we think this can be especially true at early stages of the epidemic. I will tell you a little bit more about that, when there was no response from the government or the international community. So if people really wanted to have information or care, they rely on their social network. On the other hand, the relationship can be opposite in case we think cell phone access improve access to information, improve access to care. In the first case, with access of information, this can lead to information about prevention activities, hygiene practices, and if that's materializing changing behavior, then cell phone access can decrease the likelihood of having an Ebola case. And similarly, in the case of what we call the care channel or care mechanism, it's possible that people are more likely to be able to access care, so request an ambulance or tell the government that they have a sick person in the household, a bad person in the household with symptoms, and they could request someone to come to pick the body or an ambulance to go to the hospital. If that's the case, again, then the relationship should be negative. I know now we're dealing with the coronavirus, but just as a reminder for everyone about the Ebola epidemic in Liberia, it was the largest epidemic in the history of the disease. In the country specifically, there were about 11,000 cases and about 5,000 deaths. It was the highest number among the three countries in West Africa, with Guinea and Sierra Leone. The epidemic started in Liberia in March 2015, and by the beginning of the 2015, there were fewer than 10 cases per week. I just wanted to show you the timeline. So in this graph on the x-axis, you have each month from the beginning, March 2013 to May or June, when basically it was in practice over. And on the y-axis, you have the number of cases per week. So in the in Liberia, the peak was in September, around September 2014. In what I call the first part of the epidemic, the government tried to do its best with these resources they had. So they closed the border, they closed the school, they quarantined some of the slums in the capital city, but there was not much done in terms of a kind of aggressive response. So everything really happened at the peak of the epidemic, when Liberia, after declaring a state of emergency, appealed to the international communities and the US government, the United Nations, the World Bank, sent a lot of resources and help. So the response in terms of constructing Ebola treatment units, community care center, or sending burial teams to safely bury people happened really after the peak of the epidemic. So in terms of data, we are using for our outcome of interest, that is Ebola, we are using some data that I was able to gather from the Ministry of Health that contained more than 90,000 people that were tested because of suspected of Ebola between March 2013 and July 2015, that is our study period. And the data are supplemented also with alternative data sources to make sure that they contain all the patients that were actually tested. Because there is a location of where the patient was reporting that case, we are able to create a village level measure of Ebola. And we're using a dichotomous variable, so a dummy that is takes value one, whether there is one probable confirm or death case that were recorded in that village during the study period. In terms of cell phone coverage, we were able to gather data from the Liberia Telecommunication Authority on the location of the towers before the beginning of the outbreak, so in 2013, with all the characteristics of the tower, the radio frequency, and so on. And we gathered that from the two main cell phone companies that at that point in time were at about 91% of the market share. We are estimating through a irregular terrain model this signal strength on the ground. So this is basically a radio wave propagation model that predicted the strength of coverage. And we're doing that in a very granular level for 100 meter by 100 meter cell for the entire Liberia. This model has been well validated in the literature, in past studies via on-ground measurement, and is also one of the better suited models for mobile phone waves that are super high frequency radio waves compared to radio waves for TV or radio. There are several inputs. We have about 30 variables, but this can be summarized in three broader categories. One refers to the characteristic of the transmitter of the cell phone tower and their location. There are characteristics about the topography, as well as other variables like the climate zone in which Liberia is, or whether there is land coverage, for example, there is a forest or there are trees and so on. So the measure that we have, that the output of the model is in practice the power received at any point on the ground and is measured in decibel milliwatt. And the idea is really going from a 0 bar to 1 bar, 2 bars, and so on your cell phone to be able to make a call or send a text message. So our threshold will be the 95 decibel milliwatt, that is where kind of the phone that on one side the phone doesn't work and on the other side the phone is really able to make a call. So before going in the details of the regression discontinuity design, this is a map of Liberia. You have the 15 counties. The capital city is the star, and each of the blue dot that you see on the map is a tower. So what the model predicts is basically the signal strength on the ground around the tower. So what we're using the threshold of 95 decibel watt. So that basically like the threshold between the red zone that you see on the map and the orange and then yellow and so on. So I want to just tell people also that the parts where there is no cell phone coverage are really mostly forest. There are no even villages there. It's not that there is no cell phone coverage. So the regression discontinuity design exploits the discontinuity in the ability to make the call at the sensitivity threshold of the receiver, that is 95 decibel milliwatt in absolute values. So the outcome of interest is this Ebola indicator for whether a village has at least one case. The regressor of interest is whether the village has a coverage, and that is the D I variable for village I. We are also taking into account the received power net of the cutoff 95 through a flexible function and polynomial function. We are doing a lot of robustness tests that I'm going to show you. And we are also controlling for topography, like elevation and terrain slope, and a flexible function of those two. The bandwidth is chosen optimally. I don't have the table here, but going closer and closer to the cutoff, the characteristic in terms of geography and sociodemographics are similar, and so we are using within the 10 decibel milliwatt bandwidth is really what will be closer to the optimal one. So just to show you immediately the jump, we find this is kind of the discontinued change, the likelihood of Ebola. So on the y-axis, you have the probability that the village was affected, that's at least one case. And on the x-axis, you have the signal strength, it just being normalized. So the zero, it corresponds to the 95 threshold that we are using. So you see a jump and a reduction in the likelihood of having Ebola if there is a mobile phone coverage. This is the right side. So here in kind of in a regression framework, you can see the same results. So we have a baseline specification with a set of control for geography. We also have an additional set of controls in column two. Column three report different polynomial for specification for the topography. Column four specify an increase in a kind of a larger bandwidth. So the optimal bandwidth is between 8 and 9 decibel milliwatt. We are using a larger one up to 50. And then there are variation with the kernel choice. And we also specify a probit model. So as you can see, the results are kind of are consistent in places where there is mobile phone coverage. There is a decrease in the likelihood that the village was affected by Ebola of about 10 percentage points. So the results are robust to alternative Ebola specification, different bandwidth. We are also, in an alternative specification, we are exploiting the data about Ebola that are monthly, so the panel data, and we are also looking at kind of the contagion effect within a certain district. And what we find is that there are definitely contagion effects. So if a village is in a district that has already been affected, it's more likely to be affected. But if that village also has mobile phone coverage, the contagion effect are really diminished. And what I think is more important in terms of robustness is controlling for what is called free space model. So our model, like a simplified version of our terrain model, is what is called free space. And the idea is that you predict the signal strength from the tower to the mobile phone, to the location, just based on the line of sight from the transmitter to the receiver. So what we do is we are also controlling for that signal strength and that coverage in our main specification. Idea is that if we control for that, we are trying to really only isolate kind of the idiosyncratic changing in the topography. So once we have established the reduction in the likelihood of having Ebola, what we really care about is why is that happening? What are the mechanisms? So we try to exploit the introduction of a toll-free nationwide alert system that was established from the government as a link between the public and whatever the government could offer. So the hotline number opened on August 7, but was really operational about 1 month later. So it pretty much correspond to the peak of the epidemic, that was September. And this hotline number could be called by people to just ask about information or request the dispatchment of the ambulances or request burial teams to come and help with the burials or pick suspected corpse. So what we have in mind is that if there is a network effect, even if we don't see that, because we said the relationship should be the opposite of what we see, but if we suspect maybe there is some sort of network effect, these network channels should be more relevant pre-hotline, in the pre-hotline period, because at that point in time, the government was not doing much, the international community was not helping with response. Instead, if we think this reduction in the Ebola case, in the probability of having an Ebola case is driven by either the informational care channel, then we should see those results more relevant in the second part, in like the post-hotline period. So here, just to give you a sense of that, we see that this jump is basically mainly driven by the post-hotline time. So we want to distinguish between this information and care channels. So we are exploiting survey data that I collected about 6 months after the end of the epidemic. I was able to interview about 2,200 people in about 600 villages in the entire Liberia through random dialing of phone numbers. So my survey was basically a mobile phone, one through interactive voice response and mobile phone survey conducted by a local NGO, kind of real enumerators. What is key is that it was done in 2016, but in 2013, about 30% of those individuals that they interviewed and had phone in 2016, they actually did not have phone. So these are, this allow us to, they were in an area where there was no coverage. So these allow us to have about 30% with no coverage, 70% with coverage. So that's enough. That's enough variation to explore in a more suggestive way the results and the mechanism of the results. So we create several kind of information and care outcomes. So we ask people whether governments, health worker, or NGOs came to the village to either explain what Ebola was, hold hygiene meetings, share information about prevention activities and hygiene practices, and explain how to conduct safe burials. And this is what we use to look at the information channel. We also ask people whether this institution came to bring prevention material like chlorine or buckets, do contact tracing or take sick people to the hospital or dead bodies to burial. And we also look at whether the ambulance arrived early enough, within 4 hours from when it was called. That's kind of the median that we see in the data, and whether community care center were built closer to the village. And we think these represent a potential way of looking at care or the provision of care in those villages. So we basically replicate the regression discontinuity design using these information and care outcomes. And the first table look at the information. The last column is always a summary index of all the outcomes and is expressed in standard deviation. So what you can see is that there is no effect of cell phone coverage on information. So we don't see differences in levels of information in places that were had cell phone coverage or did not have cell phone coverage. Instead, we see some suggestive evidence that in places where there is cell phone coverage, the respondents were more likely to report that people were coming to take sick relatives, the ambulance were more likely to arrive on time, community care center were more likely to be built within closer to the village within the 10 kilometers radius. And that's kind of summarized in the care index in column 7.2. So just to conclude, we find evidence that mobile phone, I'm finishing a little bit earlier. So that mobile phone coverage help contain the disease, in this case, Ebola epidemic. And that's true even in the time of crisis. In a setting like Liberia, where there is general mistrust towards authority, especially the government, when we explore the channels of impact, we find suggestive evidence that kind of interventions that are designed to improve access to care seems to be potentially more effective than intervention designed to increase the level of information of people. And we think this is kind of plausible or not unexpected, in the sense that at the time of the crisis, like for example, at the time of the epidemic, the return to having an additional ambulance are kind of higher than having an additional information session on what Ebola was or what not to do, not to shake hands and so on. And in addition to that, we also think that we can share information, but really what people need to do is to act on that information and change their behavior, and changing people's behaviors require time. Just in terms of policy implication, we think, as we can see today, infectious disease epidemics will keep happening. New viruses will unfortunately appear again. And really the ultimate costs, human or economic, can be mitigated through governmental action. So in terms of what policymakers can do, we think in normal times, there should be more investment in mobile phone technology, and I'm really excited to see the next paper actually in terms of investing in towers, and that could help reach potentially remote area that do not have access, cannot use mobile phone, not have access, not have phone coverage. And of course, this is not something feasible at the time of crisis, but at the time of crises, the technology is there, then policymaker can exploit cell phone coverage and cell phone technology with intervention that could help improve access to care. Thank you.
Great, thanks so much, Elisa. Just to let everyone know, we've got a really large number of people logged in. We're almost up to 40 people for this session. So great job, everyone. So I want to open it up to questions from Armon and DJ, if you have any questions for Elisa. And then there's a question or two from the audience as well that we can put forward as well.
You want to go first, DJ? Or?
Yeah, you can go first.
Sure. So first of all, thanks a lot, Elisa. As we'll get to my next talk, definitely some things here that are super related. Thanks to the organizers for putting together a really consistent.
Yeah.
And I do want to keep it pretty short, because looking, I can see the attendees, Josh, and there's a great group of folks here that have a lot more expertise on this than me. So I'm just going to ask like two quick questions that I'm curious about.
Yeah.
One is just how you're thinking about the fact that people can move to where there is signal to make calls, mm-hmm. Especially if you're sort of relying on these sort of close geographic cutoffs. How does that fit into the way you're thinking about this actual sort of treatment?
Yeah.
And then the second question, well, I'll just start with that.
Okay. I think that's definitely an important point. The worry is that if you have a mobile phone, you can always walk to the next village and try to get cell phone coverage. So we're thinking about is an intention to treat effect in that sense. We also think that depend on which country, like the incentives potentially of having a phone when you don't know that you cannot use it might not be so high, if especially getting a phone or having pay for being able to send a text message or internet is a high cost, in especially remote areas. But so as we're thinking about is an intention to treat, that's the short answer. So we are not able to exclude that as a possibility. We think the incentive to actually own a phone is low, but if you don't have cell phone coverage, that's an important point. Yes, thank you.
Great. Yeah, that relates to my second question, which was, you mentioned this briefly, but when you went and surveyed 6 months later, you asked mm-hmm. phones and if they had coverage, how well does that correlate with your model? I'm just curious. Obviously, there's probably a lot of measurement error, but.
Yes. So you, with the terrain model, you mean?
Yeah.
So I have to So what we can see is that there is there was even like from the tower data that we were able to get is that there was a lot of investment. It was a bit surprising, but in the sense that during the Ebola epidemic in 2014 and 2015, there were a lot of building new towers. So I was not personally surprised to see that 30% of people did not have cell phone coverage at that time, after seeing that there was a lot of infrastructure investment at that point. But I need to go back to check the terrain model.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you for suggesting.
So my question is about the mechanism. I think you mentioned there are three channels that you had, and then it looks like the care channel is the most promising one among the three. And I think you showed as your main results whether using the indicator function whether there is any reported like positive number reported case in each village. Mm-hmm. But I was wondering what you think about the care outcomes being more like potentially powerful on the extensive margin that once you find there's at least one person sick in your village, then you start calling ambulance, because if there's no one like sick in your village, then you don't have to like bring carers to take care of the sick people. So I was wondering, how do you like relate those, the mechanism, care mechanisms with the extensive margin results, what did you find for your extensive results other than the intensive margin?
Yeah, so I agree with you. It's definitely let me take one step back in the sense that the number of cases of Ebola, because there are things like that's increased measurement error. It's something that we can look at, and we have alternatives. Specification, instead of using number of cases or number of cases per capita, we are using how long you have been affected by Ebola, number of months. So we can definitely look at that too. That's a good suggestion. I agree with you that kind of the mechanism might be, the care mechanism might be more likely thinking about if you have already one case, even though like, I think also the information channel can be related to having at least one case, in the sense that people are not thinking about Ebola until it actually is happening in their village. So it's also possible that maybe you don't know what to do, and if you know that your neighbor has Ebola or suspect that you have Ebola, then you call out and want to know what you have to do or what Ebola is. So I agree that probably is more likely with the care mechanism, but I also think that the response of people, if there is to access information or to access care, is relevant in both cases when one case. Yeah, I think it's a good suggestion, though. We should look at other measures of Ebola and how they correlate with outcomes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we have a couple questions from Josh Blumenstock here. So I'll quickly ask you these, Elisa. So he asks, I'm curious about your thoughts on using a sharp RD at the 95 dBm threshold rather than a fuzzy RD, given that the signal strength decays gradually and not discontinuously. He also asks, given the late nature of the RD, what can you say about the villages that exist at the border of coverage? Are they peri-urban, poor, wealthy, or from other health centers?
Yeah, so that's the first one, definitely a good point. We thought about it. It's definitely in the sense that the coverage is definitely a continuous function. So we choose the 95 threshold for two reasons. Like one is, we are being conservative in what we think because of the type of network, the GSM network, that's the threshold for which like the phone either work or doesn't work. And then also where we see the cutoff, we try to change it a little bit. We could potentially report more of that, more robustness check with that. The other, in terms of the type of villages across the border, when we go closer to the threshold, I'm sorry, I didn't report that table. When we are closer to the, but you can see it in the paper, closer to the threshold, especially within the 10 decimal milliwatts range, that's like the optimal chosen one, they're very, very, very similar. But it's definitely true that farther you go, so we have the 20 and then the 50, there is difference between coverage and non-coverage. So coverage are more likely to be urban or close to the city. We think that we avoid that in the sense that our regressionist continuity is within the 10 decimal milliwatt range. I hope I answered the two questions.
Great. Yeah, I think that's it. And oh wait, we have one.
I don't see it. I see.
Yeah, you see.
Yeah, okay.
So it's rather, are these villages different from the rest of Liberia?
Oh, sorry. No, we think. I didn't read that. Yeah. So no, we think like actually like most of the variation is coming from kind of less, I would say, outside the big city, less urban. I don't know if you see the map. I can also go back. The cutoff is between the red and the orange and then the yellow. So it's not exactly like all, for example, all the capital city is covered. So the variation is not coming from big capital city. It's coming from places outside. And some of the places definitely more rural areas or closer to the forest are farther away from our threshold.
Great. Okay, thanks so much, Elisa. That was fantastic.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, and before we head on to the next presentation, just want to remind everyone that you can ask questions in the Q&A icon on your screen.
I will also.
Go ahead, Elisa.
No, I was also going to say that if anyone has more comments or questions, I would definitely be happy to chat later on or having kind of an email discussion. I would love more comments on the paper. It's a pretty new one, so. Great. Thank you.